So thank you guys. If you are members of the horse racing community here in Indiana, thank you so much for coming. Thank you for your support. If you are interested in anything about horse racing, whether it be thoroughbred, quarter horse, or standardbred, we have a lot of staff from the commission here. We have a lot of brochures and pamphlets for you guys that are available if you want. Feel free to take them. Feel free to talk to us. And all horse racing starts in pretty soon, so we're excited for spring. Our first topic is going to be covered by Dr. Tim Gudahus, and I'll let him take over. We're also going to hear from Dr. Alec Tavern and Dr. Javier Martinez, so we're really lucky to be able to listen to all three veterinarians with the Centaur Equine Specialty Hospital. Thank you, Dr. Gudahus.
Well, thanks, Megan, for the introduction. Thank you all for taking your valuable time during folding season and spending the afternoon with us, or a couple of hours this afternoon with us. And when the Racing Commission approached us a couple of weeks ago, if we were to be willing to be part of this, of course, we are, because we're part of the community, same as you. We live this with pride and joy every day and every hour of the day, whether it's during the week or the weekends. And unfortunately, that's kind of where a lot of these things go wrong. And my motivation behind being part of this, or us being part of this, is so we would get a chance, ideally, before things happen. Because the worst part to have discussions, I always feel, is when time is of the essence and the mare is waiting for our help, the foal is stuck and is waiting for our help, and then all of a sudden we need to have long meetings and maybe an owner needs to be called. So I think being prepared is part of the motivation to come together today. And we've reorganized the arrangement a little bit, so we start with things going wrong and then we go to infertility, and then very much last, once the foal is on the ground and things go wrong with the foal, it's going to be the finishing presentation. And a little bit beyond the little word dystocia, I want to talk in this presentation about things in general kind of going wrong in the last few weeks of gestation, right at birth, or within maybe the first 24 hours after birth, so a little bit beyond just the C-section part of it, but it's going to come up here. And obviously, if things are at this point, everybody's happy, healthy foals on the ground, and you know, ideally a few minutes after this, it stands and nurses, and at least the first big part is out of the way. But unfortunately, that's not always a guarantee, and I think that's what we all have to agree on. The big part for us, despite all the examinations that we do, all the efforts that have gone in from your veterinarian's side in terms of possibly AI or a life cover, all the monitoring that happens throughout gestation in terms of ultrasound and foal viability, there still is a big unknown that gets lost in that big three-dimensional abdomen that is the mare. And when we talk about neonatal care, or we talk about monitoring in human medicine, I think a big advantage is that the physical dimension are just so much smaller, meaning the penetration of machines for detection of abnormalities early on are just so much more in the favor of the diagnostician than in our case. And so oftentimes only at the time of birth do we start realizing things that are unfortunate and then maybe get in the way with things going normal. And so the big topics I want to cover today, factors around the time of birth, are uterine torsion, uterine prolapse, broad ligament hemorrhage. Colic is a very general term, where the foal may add up to or get in the way, truly get in the way of what we want to do. And then last but not least, and spending most of the talk on, we will talk about the true dystocias, the malpositions, the malformations, and all the other issues leading to the need for either an assisted or controlled vaginal delivery, or worst case scenario, a C-section. I don't know who all has experienced uterine torsion, seen that happen in mares. It can be very broad, I guess, in terms of symptoms. It can go from a high heart rate, a high respiratory rate, general colicking symptoms, and usually the diagnosis is made by the veterinarian at the farm. Uterus is not free-floating in the abdomen, that would be bad. It obviously needs to be controlled where it is for its blood supply, so it is attached, and in a four-legged animal, different than in people, Obviously, the uterus is usually in a horizontal alignment, hung up, if you will, at the roof of that abdomen by a curtain-like structure that supports those uterine horns, also brings the blood supply to the ovaries and the uterus. And if we look at that from the backside, we can basically see that, if you will, almost two-point type attachment. It's not two points, it's a curtain-like structure that supports the weight of the uterus that obviously gets heavier and heavier throughout gestation. And when this uterus starts making a sudden move, which could be initiated by the foal or it could be initiated by the mare rolling and the foal and the uterus stay stationary, all of a sudden we have a topographical change, and now all of a sudden we have a malposition. They're defined in either clockwise or anti-clockwise, and they can go anywhere from 90 degrees to about 360 degrees. Depending on all those variables, obviously, there's going to be different degrees of pain, discomfort, and distress for that mare. In general, we have to say that whilst this is a top differential for any colicking mare in late gestation, there's a clear cutoff in terms of prognosis. Very generally speaking, the prognosis for the mare is always better than for the foal, and with somewhere very close to 100%, nothing is guaranteed, but usually the survival rate for the mare is pretty good. The survival rate for the foal in general is fair, and the cutoff date at about the last month of gestation or the last 2 weeks of gestation is an indicator that the later this happens, usually our prognosis drops. And again, these numbers don't mean anything for an individual patient. I put them up here. They've been generated over the last few decades around the world. But a uterine torsion is not the end of the world, but it needs to be fixed. What do we have to treat those? And we can also print those out or put them as PDFs or make them maybe available on the website. So if you can't read this, I apologize, maybe on the very last seats, but I'm gonna talk you through everything that's on these slides. There's different techniques to help this condition. The least invasive one is that we try and roll the mare under general anesthesia. That means we don't make an incision into the abdomen, we don't manipulate the uterus in proportional relation to the mare's body. This is a drawing that I found, which actually shows this to be done on a cow, because the incident that occurs with different species, it's the very same thing here. And whilst we don't have to make an incision, we don't actually, with our hand, touch the embryo or the fetus, and we don't have to manipulate things. That is all great. The downside is that it's also the least controlled way of guaranteeing a positive fix and getting things back to normal. Every other step from there becomes more invasive. And sorry, I jumped one forward. We have the option of treating this as a standing condition. So we make a flank approach and we try and rock that uterus and basically trying to derotate it. And the alternative is that we do a proper approach to the abdomen, same as we do in any other condition to the abdomen, through a ventral midline, so the mare's on her back, and we physically twist that uterus into the normal position. Again, survival is usually good for the mares, fair for the foals, a bit depending on when it happens. Uterine prolapse is a bit more of an exceptional thing, but it's common enough that I want you all to see what that looks like and what that would mean for you, because you would be the first ones to actually treat this mare before the first veterinarian would set foot on the ground. And be available, or this mare possibly shipping to a facility where she gets help. And the biggest thing when the uterus prolapses, which is usually happening after birth, okay, due to different reasons, not all too uncommonly due to a retained placenta that is aggressively treated with oxytocin or manipulated lavage, things that irritate that uterus, all of a sudden you see more or less of that structure coming out the back end. The most important thing as a first line emergency treatment is to actually support it by gravity, so that the blood supply doesn't engorge the tissue and it doesn't become heavier and bigger, because the harder and harder it gets to bring it actually back to where it belongs, the more friable the tissue becomes. So as a very first line treatment, take a large towel, a bed sheet, a tablecloth, it doesn't matter what, anybody that can assist you, support the tissue, and either a veterinarian comes on site and helps you there to reposition, or she needs to be transported to a facility where she can get support in order to reposition things. Again, prognosis usually is favorable if things don't get too far down the road in time. Broad ligament hemorrhage is something that usually happens after birth. I still put it up here because it is a fairly common or common enough condition that I wanted you all to hear the definition of it. Again, the uterus isn't just free hanging in that abdomen, which would be a bad thing to have that fall in there and moving about. So it is supported in that curtain-like structure that is obviously a paired structure because the uterus has two horns. Usually one of these horns is the gravid horn, so it is heavier. And as that foam moves around during birth, or potentially it happens during birth, but the clinical symptoms don't show till variable amounts of time in the first 24 hours after birth, what happens is that that foam can actually pinch or lacerate the blood support within that broad ligament. It comes to a fairly profuse hemorrhage that can be either free into the abdomen, sometimes if the vaginal roof is perforated with it or the uterus is perforated with it, there's actually overt hemorrhage coming out the vagina as well. But usually you don't see anything happening, meaning that Mare starts becoming uncomfortable, she becomes maybe lethargic, her mucous membranes become wider and wider. And this is our top differential whenever we have these factors coming together. Pale mucous membranes, high heart rate, distressed or painful Mare. And the unfortunate part about this condition is that only about on average 50% of these Mares can be salvaged because these blood vessels are very big to support the foal growing during these many months. And unfortunately, due to the size of these blood vessels on cross-section, if you imagine these vessels being lacerated, every one of us has seen a laceration on a limb when an artery is cut, how that bleeds. You multiply that by the diameter of one of these vessels, that can be a very rapid condition despite treatment in our care. And I wanted you to be aware of this because if you have a Mare that fits these criteria, I think she should be seen by someone. Colic, I put it up here and I don't want to get into further detail what affects the GI tract. I just want us all to be aware that putting a growing foal into that equation doesn't make things simpler for us. And the later we come in gestation, the harder it gets, because the foal starts taking up a large diagnostic window for us, whether that is from the outside with an ultrasound, whether that is transrectally for us to try and palpate GI structures, when now all of a sudden we've got 90 or 100 pounds worth of fluids and foam in there taking up a large space, it pushes everything else out of the way. So it makes diagnostics harder for us, and it makes the treatment harder for us too, which quite often leads us to maybe making a roundabout decision saying we need to explore an abdomen because we don't know if the foal is in jeopardy. Maybe we can exclude the uterine torsion that I had mentioned before, but all the other factors and variable options that could be the cause for the condition, very generic, colic, the Mare is painful, we need to explore that. And sometimes also it pushes us closer to the decision if at the time of that surgery, for whatever reason we need to perform it, is it time to potentially at the same time do a C-section with that, get the foal out and out of the way literally in order for us to do what we need to do to the GI tract, for example. Now I'm coming to the true dystocia when things are really going to action and things should go smooth and fast and something doesn't go right. And something doesn't go right can be along the lines of what we see here. Everybody knows that this should be 180 degrees the other way around, meaning the fetlocks in the feet should be pointing downward. Ideally, there should be a nostril to be felt or seen at the same time here in a normal presentation. So when we see something like this, it is hard to tell. Are these hind legs? Are these front legs? Where is the head? We are obviously in stage two of labor. The foal could still be alive, sometimes hard to determine if you can't get to the head, hard to determine for us as well. But long story short, you got a time window, and that time window is very short. So if something like this happens and you can't have ready help at home, this is the moment where you should be calling me, not to see if you should come, but you should be calling me on the way with the Mare on the trailer saying we're going to be hitting the ground here in 20 or 30 minutes. And again, I put this picture up before. This was my Christmas 2015, one of those unknowns. Nobody was aware that the development of that foal was normal or abnormal. And then obviously, you know, this can't be delivered normally through the pelvic inlet, unless in this case the foal was dead. We could actually decompress that hydrocephalus and we could create enough space or have enough space to deliver it vaginally. This is the normal presentation at birth. This is what we all want to see. Two front legs coming out basically in a downward direction. Why is that important? Because all these joints following up from the fetlock to the knee, to the elbow, to the shoulder, only flex and extend pretty much one way. So we turn that all upside down. At some point, the mobility, I guess, of that apparatus, and then further on the spine and the hind legs, it limits us to what we can actually naturally deliver through that pelvic inlet. And when we are somewhere different from this, or when the head is not present, is flexed to the side, obviously we've got a problem and we need to interfere. I put all these different pictures up here. And again, if we put that on the website, you can look at these. Maybe you can still follow me from very far in the back as well. The big differentiation is here, how does that fold present in terms of, is it in what we call an anterior presentation, which means the front end comes first, the head with it, whether the head is actually flexed down, flexed to the side, whether the fold is upside down, or whether it's in a posterior presentation, means the pelvis comes first in whatever alignment, and wherever the head may be, makes a big factor for us whether or not we will actually have a reasonable chance to deliver that fold via natural opening, or whether we're gonna have to make that next step towards a C-section. Now, this is a little bit of a rodeo picture. I found that online. I'm not saying good or bad, because the reality is, if you can get a fold out vaginally and you can save that life and do it fast, this may be the way to go. So I'm not discriminating anybody. I just thought it was a cool picture. But this is technically still an assisted vaginal delivery. And I want to explain these terms. Assisted to us means the mare is still standing, whether or not she has an epidural. We're basically delivering the fold the way it should be delivered, with the mare being conscious, whether or not she works with us. There was a different talk, but there were two talks apparently generated, and this is the one. Controlled delivery, just to follow that definition, means we're actually turning the mare upside down. We're putting her under short general anesthesia, and I had some clinic pictures where that's done properly with a hoist, and I had some rodeo pictures that I found online where somebody does that with a tractor. It doesn't matter how it's done. Why do we call that controlled? Because if we jump back one or two slides and we see all these forms of positionings and presentations, oftentimes when we are stuck in any one of these alignments here, or variable factors, where is the front limb, is it flexed backward, at the shoulder, at the carpus, is it in a hock flexion, it doesn't matter. When part of the fold is basically stuck in the birth canal, it becomes harder and harder for us to manipulate that fold. So by turning that mare, taking her conscious awareness of what we're doing away, taking contractions away, with or without an epidural, there's always gonna be some work that's happening against the mare. Taking all that out of the equation allows us to manipulate things more aggressively. If we hoist that mare up by her hind legs, I'm actually able to push that fold back in, and it's literally like mixing the cards new. I can start grabbing for something that's in better favor for me to get maybe one front leg in the head and actually start to pull her in and get that fold out, as opposed to that kind of stuck in between position that's getting nobody anywhere. So again, that's a cascade of events from assisted vaginal delivery to controlled delivery, and then ultimately, obviously, we're gonna be dealing with the C-section. The reason why I put this picture up here was to point out the malformations. Those malformations can be of varying degrees, and while this fold here, I think, is still gonna do okay with dealing with the flexural deformity, I think you can follow my thought if I tell you that if that is contracted even any further, this may be a very limiting factor for me to actually use natural pliability or dynamics of the locomotor system to be able to pull that fold in, even though it's maybe in a good presentation. I'm still gonna be unable to potentially get one of these folds out in a natural way. And if this guy looks at you, well, there's a good chance there is more than that malformation. This is a cyclops, and usually that's obviously not alive, or if it is alive, sometimes these folds can be alive, it won't be alive for very long. The things that we use for either one of these techniques, just so you don't feel like we revert you to the Middle Ages, but
These obstetric chains and handles are my bread and butter, and they're literally my lifeline because everything is slippery. We're using abundant amounts of gel and lubricant. In addition, we don't want any lacerations or injuries to the birth canal, the soft tissues towards the future soundness of that mare, as well as the acute ramifications from any type of injury. We talked about hemorrhage, etc. So being able to apply force, but apply it in a very controlled way, these chains are essential for us. And sometimes you'll see other tools such as eye hooks, and they look horribly medieval, but again, they're in the best interest. And usually when I say best interest, my best interest is always aimed at the mare's survival. That is the more important life, I'll be very honest with you. Sometimes there's exceptions to that rule, but most of the time, the mare's survival is of most interest, and the foal's survival could be questionable. Ideally, it's both, and sometimes it's none. So again, this is how things should be coming out in the normal position. This is, again, a little bit disorganized between the two talks. Unfortunately, it comes a little bit out of order. This is one form of a controlled delivery in a clinic type setting. In this case, on a table that can be lifted. I usually use the hoist for that. Now that picture still shows, obviously, wherever you are in the world and whatever you have to do in order to save a life, that may be another approach to it. And ultimately, this brings us, when everything fails, to the C-section as the last resort. We usually go in 20-minute increments max, meaning we like to start with the vaginal delivery. If I fail, latest after 20 minutes, we will progress to the next, which is the controlled delivery, unless we have clear and strong indication that that's going to fail too, in which case we will jump that step. Usually, whilst we are trying to manipulate that foal, don't be surprised if somebody's already clipping the mare's belly. That is not because I've already got my mind set and I'm just playing along, but ultimately I want to do a C-section. It is so I don't lose just even 5 minutes or 3 minutes later on. So we try to basically be prepared for the worst, even though ideally we maybe get it done with the first step. So the C-section is not necessarily the worst case scenario, and I want to take that stigma away, where maybe in the 70s and 80s, not that everything is better nowadays, but in terms of intensive care, neonatal care, surgical technique, anesthesia risk, all these factors I think have improved dramatically over the last few decades. And where C-section still, I think, in horses carries that stigma of it can't be done or it has a poor prognosis, I would like to somehow change that and as a take-home message maybe deliver today. A C-section is not the last resort, even though we put it last in line. We try to avoid it when we can, but ultimately it could be the very best step and the very best decision for the mare's life in a good number of cases if the foal is otherwise healthy, also in the foal's life. But it needs to be done under general anesthesia, and as part of this talk's topic, it's going to address at least somewhat cost. Obviously, it's not the cheapest thing. I put it up very last. I'm not a big fan of phytotomies. I've actually done a fair amount of bovine work the first few years out of school before going through my internships here in the US and my residency. I've had that chance and opportunity to be familiar with the technology and the equipment that you need. A phytotomy should always be the ultimate last resort. And I think it can only be an alternative to a C-section if it is truly about trying to preserve the last dollar, or the mare's reproductive health is not the major interest either. Let's say this is the last foal, but somebody wants to have that mare live on. I guess one could consider a phytotomy, obviously, and I hope I don't need to explain that very much. It always ends with a dead foal, and ideally, and by ethics, it should always start with a dead foal, meaning it is not an option for a live foal. But in this case, what we need to keep in mind, using, this is what we call a fetotome, and basically a loop of wire that we try and manipulate around body parts that get in the way to deliver that foal through the pelvis and through the vagina. It is, in the end, no matter how hands-on you are, no matter how experienced you are with this technique, it is always the highest risk for the mare's health. For the simple reason that no matter how controlled your cuts are, if you deliver parts of that foal, there's obviously cut bones in here, no matter where you make those cuts, on the limbs, on the pelvis, on the head, on the neck. And these sharp points have to somehow make it out through the natural orifice. It's soft tissue, it's very vascular, it's probably traumatized, it has been squeezed by the fold, it has been manipulated by us, it's extremely friable, and that's why, again, if it taught me to me, I wanted it to be in here, because some of you may have experience with it. To me, it's the last resort, and if I have a chance to talk anybody out of it, I will do that any day of the year. Well, now we come to the magic final slide. As it was part of the topic, I would like to leave it somewhat vague, but touch that topic. Why is it vague? Because if you bring me a mare that is in distress, that is potentially sick, that develops further stress-induced issues after the fact, it's hard for me to make that a package price. It's not going to Walmart and checking out with a bag of rice. This mare may develop diarrhea, she may need fluids. If she's losing a lot of blood, but we can save her life, she may need a blood transfusion, she may need a plasma transfusion. If the foal is alive, now all of a sudden we're having a second patient that may need intensive care. And I just want everybody to somewhat understand that these are all variables that go into that equation, and that's why there is not a lump sum. If you ask me what the team costs to come here in the middle of the night and have four or five people on the ground, there is a number to that. If you ask me what it costs by the time the mare goes home 12 days later with blood transfusion and a live foal that had plasma and all sorts of antibiotics, it's a mathematical effort, and you can maybe calculate that out individually. So that's my two cents on things going wrong around birth. If there's any questions right now, maybe we have a minute or two right now, and then we can maybe do a little bit of a question answer in the end. And I also want to thank Michelle very much for her support. Mm-hmm. Megan, obviously, you guys with the basic permission to put this all out.
Does anybody have any questions concerning this topic? Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Gudenhuis.